Why are you refusing to consider hearings outside the safety of the Ottawa bubble? And why are you denying Canadians an opportunity to have a say about their election process in the communities where they live?
Well, I'm not. The committee is the master of its own destiny. It can hear any witness that it wants. I would encourage you to put forward a full list that is representative of the entire country as you consider the viewpoints of Canadians from across the land before this committee. And I will leave it to you as the assembled members of the committee to determine where you hold those hearings. That being said, you did make some comments about the consultations with the CEO. You weren't at the meeting, but it was not just a hi, how are you? I listened for about an hour to the CEO's suggestions until, in fact, he ran out of things to say. I told him if he thought of anything else, he should give me a call and we could talk further. I also read his many testimonies before this committee and reports, which are publicly available, and took them into consideration in adding 38 of his recommendations to the substance of the Fair Elections Act. That is, I think, a very comprehensive consultation. And furthermore, we'll look forward to hearing input from the many witnesses that you'll bring before you.
Well, Minister, first of all, if I can share to correct my own record, it was the Transport Committee, not the Trade Committee, just to be accurate. I want to say, well, let me ask the Minister. I agree it's the committee's purview to decide whether we should go outside Ottawa. Let me ask you the question directly then. In your opinion, would it be a more democratic and healthier process for Canadians if we took these committee hearings outside of Ottawa? Your opinion?
That really is a matter for the committee to decide.
Oh, so you're dodging, Minister, and I got to tell you, this is just consistent with what we've seen. I have the floor. This is consistent with what we've seen so far. We are definitely concerned that a serial cheating government is trying to pre-cheat the next election before we even get to it. And all we're seeking at this stage is an opportunity for Canadians to have their say. The minister can be as cute as he wants saying that it's the purview of this committee, but we all know who's calling the shots. And if this minister and the prime minister said there will be public hearings outside Ottawa, there would be. They're shutting this down. And it's not a process that we're willing to accept here. Let me just last say, we want to get off the process issue. This is not where we want to fight. These are serious issues. We want to get out into the communities and talk about the bill, but we need a fair process. Ramming electoral changes through the House and then through this committee is un-Canadian and unacceptable.
There's a minute left. Give it to Mr. Scott.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Minister, for being here. I was wondering if I could go straight to an issue that's caused some concern, which is the current Section 18 of the Act, which you've replaced or want to replace with a new version that's very tight and excludes, in its own language, excludes any other public education activities other than what's listed. You've suggested some openness, and my question is, why would you not be open to retaining the current Section 18, which has all the public education functions that the has led to things like Democracy Day and the student vote program, and then layer in on top of it your specific informational duties that you want the chief electoral officer to undertake? What's wrong with having the two side by side?
Clearly, the public advertising and outreach campaigns of Elections Canada have not worked. Since they came into effect, voter turnout has actually plummeted, and the problem is even more persistent amongst the groups that the campaigns purport to help. I did some research into some of the practical obstacles to voting that exist in Canada and found that many of them are very practical. 60% of non-voters say that everyday issues got in the way of their casting a ballot. Those include everything from being out of town on Elections Day to being too busy to cast a ballot. Those are two problems that can easily be solved with advanced voting. Problem is that half of young people are not aware that they can vote in advance of Elections Day, a number that rises to three quarters when you talk about Aboriginal youth. And as a result, I think we need to advertise those basics of voting, where, when, and what ID to bring, and what two special tools are available to help the disabled cast a ballot.
Thank you, Minister. I gave some extra time there to the answer to your question. So we'll be careful on asking those compound questions with 2 seconds left, and not expect me to cut the witness off. We're going to go next to
Mr. Simms. I understand, Mr. Chair, that was the problem.
7 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. First of all, I'm going to start with a compliment. How's that? When the debate started, you were there, and you stayed throughout the whole thing. Not every minister does that, and I want to say thank you for doing that. You put up your argument as best you could. I want to go directly to the point of what the commissioner, as well as the chief electoral officer, asked for prior to this bill, which is the ability to apply to a judge to compel testimony. We know that in Section 11 of the Competition Act, this exists. So it exists on paper. It also exists in New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, Quebec, Ontario, Manitoba, Alberta, Yukon, for their election officials to be able to compel their testimony. And to me, that seems to be the one key tool that they were looking for. So, but you keep talking about independence. You wanted the independence for the commissioner to do its job, but if it doesn't have the very tool that he asked for, it can't be done. So even though you're taking that person from Elections Canada and you're putting them into the public prosecution office, without that key tool, this is an exercise in not independence, but this is an exercise in isolation. Because at least when he was with Elections Canada, he could just go down the hall, he could talk to the auditors, he could talk to deputy returning officers all across the country, because that was the only way really that he could find out what's going on, because then they could raise flags. But when the flags were raised, he was within that building. He was within that construct of Elections Canada. Now, if you want to take that person and put him over into public prosecution with the very tool to be able to do this, I think that would have been probably the best thing to do. So it's not a question of ordering the referee off the ice. You certainly took his whistle from him, which made him ineffective, or you never really gave him a whistle in the first place. And second of all, now he is off the ice. So don't you think this is more isolation than anything else?
Not at all. In fact, the Fair Elections Act will continue to permit the commissioner to ask information from Elections Canada or any of its officials. None of those powers are removed by the Fair Elections Act, nor does the new legislation prevent Elections Canada from providing information to the commissioner. They can have a free line of communication, one to the other. Well, the independence we provide is to allow the commissioner.
But Minister,
to control
if I may,
his,
if I may,
just finish answering. It was a very long question. The answer is that the commissioner will have the ability to manage his own staff, run his own investigations, and he can do so without fear of being fired because he'll have a fixed term for the first time.
Well, sir, but how often does that happen, really? I mean, to do his job effectively, obviously he has to be within the confines of this to find out what is going on. Like, look at the frustration that happened during the robocalls affair, you know? I mean, there was obfuscation, they were blocked, they were so frustrated. This is the very reason why he brought it out. I don't think by taking that person, putting them into a different office with separate, you know, in a separate place, that you say that there is an open line of communication, but there really isn't, unless he has the ability to go after people. You said that police officers do not have this ability, but your party vehemently argued for the ability to wiretap, to listen in on conversations. Vehemently you defended that. You wanted to make that better. Well, the reason why you did that is because it gave that person the tool to investigate. But it's not a question, quite frankly, you haven't made him neutral. You've made him neutered without that tool.
Nothing could be further from the truth. In fact, the Fair Elections Act gives the watchdog sharper teeth, a longer reach, and a freer hand. What does that mean? Sharper teeth means tougher penalties for existing offenses. A longer reach means that he'll have dozens of new offenses to impose. And on that particular point,
can I address those three things?
No, because I'm not finished. The reality is that the commissioner will have a new offense that he can impose, which is anybody who obstructs his investigations or lies to his investigators will be committing offense under the Act, one that can be prosecuted. And that will allow him to cut through the obstruction that so worries you. But you raise the issue of police powers to compel. Police do not have that power. Police who are investigating the most heinous violent crimes cannot force someone to speak.
But I just illustrated a point where they did.
The commissioner has all of the same powers of investigation that a police officer would have. The commissioner can...
So why is he wrong when he says he wants more?
The commissioner...
Why is he wrong? Specifically, why is he wrong? I've only got a few minutes left, Minister. Yeah. Why is he so wrong?
The power...
For asking what he wants.
The power that the commissioner has to seek information is already present under the existing Act.
Then what did he ask?
He can ask a judge for a warrant to obtain evidence, and after charges are laid...
What about before charges
are laid? The testimony can be compelled in the court of law. That's the way it works when investigators in police investigations carry out their work for much more serious crimes than you're discussing here. And the reality is that he has these tools and we're giving him more under the Fair Elections Act.
Can the police go beyond before charges? Do they have the ability to listen into conversations if they feel that you and I are up to no good? And don't you think that an investigator with Elections Canada...
That's not what you're asking for.
But that's what they're asking for.
But you've changed the subject.
No, I have not.
You were on power
to Parliament. Because this is what they... In order for them to get to the bottom of a scandal for robocalls, I'm asking for what is in Section 11 of the Competition Act.
Which is not
wiretapping. Which is exactly... But it's the power to compel for evidence, the ability to investigate effectively. Wiretapping is about police doing their jobs.
So are you talking
the Competition
about wiretapping or the power to compel?
It's about them doing their jobs.
You're going to have to decide what you're asking for, because a minute ago you were asking for the power to compel testimony. Asking for the power to wiretap.
I'm asking for the ability to investigate before charges are laid, which is what you're not providing in this legislation.
That's completely false. The commissioner has the power to investigate before charges are laid. That's what he does for a living.
To compel evidence, to apply to a judge. If the judge does not feel...
Thank you, Mr. Sims.
If I could conclude, he can compel evidence by getting a search warrant right now.
Thank you. We will go to our four-minute rounds. Mr. Lukiski, you're first.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Minister, for being here. Before I begin with you, Minister, I just want to make a comment based on what my friend and colleague David had said about the process. Following your presentation here, we will go into the second hour of this meeting to deal with process. It will be in public. I hope that I have an opportunity to talk about process, David, and if you want to take the entire hour yourself, that's up to you, but I would certainly like to present the government's position on whether or not we go on cross-country tours. So hopefully I'll have that opportunity. But Minister, to you, and I have to tell you, I was not planning to ask this question until recently. I planned to ask you some specific questions on provisions in the Act, but I have to tell you, I'm very concerned about a newspaper report that I saw recently, and it was in the Ottawa Citizen. I don't know whether it's accurate or not. I see some of our colleagues from the media here today, so I'm assuming that...
Everything in the newspaper is absolutely
accurate. That's what I was just about to say. But this concerns me because it's a story about Monsieur Menon, the head of Elections Canada, who apparently was giving some form of a speech to his employees, the staff members at Election Canada, and apparently railing against the government, complaining about the Fair Elections Act. And it almost sounded, the way I read the article, it was like almost like a campaign-style speech to rally them up, to get them angry at the government. I could only interpret that as being, in my mind at least, political activism. I may be wrong, but it certainly appeared that way to me, and I just want to know whether or not, if I interpreted it correctly, whether that, in your opinion, is appropriate for the head of Elections Canada, which is supposed to be impartial and deal with all political parties and all candidates impartially. What do you think that was appropriate?
Well,